How you doing, guys? BC90 here with the next video in my Poise Showcase series, and today we're going to be having a look at another dual wielding setup. Yes, I absolutely love these particular setups. I think they increase the versatility of these builds like crazy. So we're going to be having a look at a Greataxe plus Follower Javelin setup today. Now, the Greataxe itself is, it's a pretty awesome Greataxe in my opinion in terms of its ability to stagger. And its damage, obviously its damage output isn't as strong as other Greataxes in its class, for example the Yorm's Great Machete, but it's still quite good. It's a bit heavy though, and it's got piss poor range, but over here I've got it with a heavy gem at +9, gets a B scaling in strength, and with 50 strength you get a pretty decent 611 AR. So obviously not as much as the Yorm's Great Machete, but it does weigh a little bit less, which is good. So it adds, you can add something else to your weapon selection to increase your versatility instead. Now, another thing I might add with this weapon is the weapon art powers up the weapon AR, just like the Yorm's Great Machete. So it goes up to 672 there. But unlike the Yorm's, this one can actually be buffed. So if you use Human Pine Resin here, guys, you can actually get an AR of 706. Which, granted, again, still isn't as high as the buffed up Yorm's Great Machete with its own weapon art, but it's still pretty good. Now, the one thing I don't like about this weapon is it has probably the worst range out of all the Greataxes, in my opinion. It's got less range than the Black Knight and less range than the Yorm's Great Machete, obviously. So you really need to get in your opponent's face to hit them. But after that first hit, I've never seen a weapon... this is purely subjective, but when I get that first hit in, guys, I've never seen a weapon stagger as hard as this one. This one staggers like a truck, similar to the Pickaxe, for example. Once you get that first hit in, you're going to get a second solid, and it does a shitload of damage added up there, guys. Now, the Follower Javelin here is our offhand weapon. So if we go back to my equipment page, I've got the Follower Javelin again with a heavy gem, +9, so it gets that A scaling in strength. And if you actually have a look at my status page here, guys, you get a pretty respectable 370 AR. Now, the reason I'm using this is because obviously it gives us a range advantage that counteracts our piss poor range from our main weapon. So, and I like the spear pokes, it's quite effective offhand weapon you can poke with and lead into a second attack with your Greataxe. Now, obviously, spears are pretty easy to parry, so keep that in mind. And, if you want to, you can dual wield the Follower Javelin there if you want to use that weapon art. Although, it never really hits anyone. It's just, pretty awesome to look at, and I guess it forces your opponent to move. Now, going back over to my setup here, I've still got the two Blessed Cestus there to stack with my Sun Princess Ring when I need that HP regen. And I've also managed to add a Knight's Crossbow +10. And as you can see there, my weight ratio is still below 70%. And I'm above the 45.81 breakpoint I need to be when I two-hand the Greataxe. That way I can comfortably hyper-armor trade against everything except those Great Hammers. So we are above the breakpoint we need to be to trade against almost everything, and we do have quite a bit of versatility here. So, I whip out the Knight's Crossbow there, obviously, to punish casters, to punish passive players, and obviously to surprise people. I've advocated the use of a crossbow many times in previous videos, so, it's something to consider. I really advise that you do include it in your setups if you have the weight ratio to include them, because they will serve you well. Now, just like my previous videos with dual wielding setups, I like opening with the two-handed weapon first so people don't expect it, so we'll go straight into some matches here, guys. And I mean, the Greataxe just looks badass. It's got some pretty cool little engravings in it, that look pretty awesome, so I thought I'd do a little video with it here today, guys. Very poor timing on our part there. That's alright. Just gotta be careful here. Really time our attacks perfectly here, guys. Boom. Force that trade, you're gonna come out on top, guys. No doubt about that. And there we go. As soon as you can bait that trade or force your opponent into that trade, guys, when you're in active frames, like I mentioned in all my videos, you won't stagger. I mean, just as you saw there, we took multiple hits from those twin swords and we were just able to get our hits in and cause our opponent to stagger instead. It's such a good system in my opinion, guys. Obviously, it's different to Dark Souls 1, but when you get used to it, it is quite effective and you can really catch your opponents off guard when you're using it. We'll go straight on to the next match here, guys. Now, obviously, the normal Greataxe here, you know, isn't as good as other Greataxes in its class. You know, I prefer the Yorm's Great Machete and the Black Knight Greataxe, but, you know, it is lighter than those two other Greataxes, and you do have the versatility there to be able to equip a lot more weapons in your arsenal to deal with different threats as opposed to those other two weapons. So, you know, it's cool in that way that it allows that versatility in your setups. And it still hits pretty hard on its own, to be honest. So we got a... got another... bait us into a parry, but we're not going to parry. We're going to delay a little bit. I mean, sorry. That didn't make sense. That guy was trying to bait us into a parry for a rolling R1, right? Because the rolling R1s are parryable. But yeah, we're going to delay our R1 after the roll, so we don't actually succumb to that parrying tactic. And there we go. So yeah, I'm sorry if that didn't make sense there, guys, because, you know, I do record my commentary live as I'm fighting, but basically what I was trying to say is, when you have an opponent that, you know, is obviously trying to bait out a parry, and he knows that your rolling R1s are parryable, you know, when you come out of that roll, just delay for a second. Delay your attack by 1 second and you'll hit them with the unparryable attack instead, and you'll hit them for 2 because you'll force them to stagger. So it really catches those parry kings off guard. Alright, straight on to the next match here, guys. All in all, though, I like the Greataxe, guys. I don't think it's, you know, the best in its class, obviously, but, you know, it looks pretty cool. It hits like a truck. Works really well with your poise breakpoints. You know, it still does a significant amount of damage with 50 strength. And, you know, you're allowed that versatility, like I mentioned before, to have something like this. So hopefully we'll get to showcase this. But really, with your sidearms, guys, they're called sidearms for a reason. You're only whipping them out when you need to, so you don't really need to have them equipped all the time so your opponent knows what you're doing. You just whip them out on an as-needed basis, so you have that versatility there when it's required. Knew that was coming. Didn't dodge that one very well. I mean, I don't know, sometimes I get lazy fighting these katanas, I guess. Mainly because I see them so damn much. There we go, as soon as you force that trade, you're in for the win. And let's see now. Oh, he went for the backstab, that was good. I like that. Gotcha. And there we go, wasn't expecting the crossbow. So there you go, guys. Whip him out on an as-needed basis. You know, I tried to finish him off with the spear there, but, you know, because it's a spear and it hits, you know, directly in front of you, like that guy did, it's pretty easy for someone to get behind you to backstab. So, you know, instead I was thinking, alright, so this guy's probably going to go for another one of those pokes, you know, because he knows he's not going to get that weapon art in with me, because I'm either going to, you know, just dodge it, because it's super easy to dodge, or try and hyper-armor through it, but, you know, you have to really get your timing right to hyper-armor through them, and it's harder to do with Greataxes, in my opinion, because I have a slower wind-up. So in that chance, I mean, in that situation, I was more happy to just dodge them, to be honest, and finish him off there with the crossbow. So yeah, keep that in mind, guys. If you do want to actually hyper armor through those weapon arts that I mentioned in previous videos, including that Onikiri weapon art, you have to get your timing down like absolutely perfect. Because if that weapon art hits you when you're in your startup frames, you're gonna receive pretty much the full combo. But you know, as long as you're in those active frames, you're gonna be able to you know, hit them while they do that weapon art. You're not gonna stagger yourself, and you'll usually be able to hit them again. You know, when they end up behind you. So it's pretty good that you can interrupt that weapon art, because it's super annoying, to be honest. But, you know, if you get good at dodging it, I'm pretty good at dodging it, to be honest with you, because I fight it so much, you don't really need to. I mean, you can just dodge it and react appropriately, in my opinion. Okay, so there's another situation where this guy's waiting for me to do a rolling R1, and instead I'm going to delay it. He got us pretty good there, though, with that that attack. Gotcha. So yeah, guys, once you master that delayed R1 coming off a roll, it's going to serve you really well against these parry guys. Because with these unparryable attacks that you normally have when you two-hand these weapons, your only weaknesses are that rolling R1 and the running R1. So when you learn to anticipate someone who's trying to bait you into doing those attacks, you can counter-attack by, you know, delaying those attacks or not using them at all. So I'm a big fan of the delayed R1, to be honest, because you still roll into your opponent, so they usually expect you to go into that rolling R1, so it's really good against those parry guys, those parry kings guys. Straight on to the next match here, guys. Just showcasing the moveset there a little bit. So your standard Greataxe attacks there, the R1s, the charged R2s, and again the weapon art changes that R2 again, similar to the Yorms and the Great Hammer. Oh, we're gonna have trouble here, guys. We're gonna have trouble here. Not if we get our timing right. So let's get our timing right. Trying to catch him there, but we may not be able to. Obviously, we have a lot less range here than this guy, even with our follower javelin, so we've got to be selective here with our hits. Ooh, I thought I had him there. We'll switch it up here. No, no good. See if we can get a little bit of HP back here. Close match. He's got us on the defensive here, he knows it. He knows that this match could end any minute. Oh shit, I have way too much fun with this stuff, guys. Will he make a mistake? 30 seconds on the clock. Oh, almost got him. Almost got him. Oh, that was good. So he's obviously pissed. Oh, don't be angry, man. You couldn't beat me. Oh, no. Oh, God. I don't know, I just like trolling sometimes, guys. But honestly, in those matchups, you know, the Gargoyle Flame Spear is a well-known meta weapon. You're going to struggle against it. That guy wasn't the best player I've seen using that weapon, so that was lucky for us. But, you know, unfortunately, you do need a bit more time to come out on top than the what the arena allows you, because you're going to be forced to play the neutral game yourself and pick your attacks, pick your hits, time your attacks. So, you know, I had to play the neutral game for a little bit there for a bit of HP regen, and then mix it up a little bit with that follower javelin. So really, in a situation, for example, where you're at Pontiff's, you know, there's no time limit and you can create pressure for, you know, as long as you want. And I actually managed to hit that guy there before the match was over, and I only needed one more hit there to kill him. So whether I would have got that in, we'll never know. But at least in Pontiff's, you know, after that last hit, without the time limit, it would have created a lot of pressure for him, in my opinion. So, you know, try these builds out in Pontiffs as well, guys, if you have the chance. Just so you can really get good at your neutral game and be able to come out on top against those neutral players when you sort of out-passive them, I guess. Or when you're forced to play the neutral game against them in order to get HP regen back. Because it's good to get a feel for the capabilities of your build. I'm getting my ass kicked by a torch here. Albeit a really good torch player. I just had to get a crossbow in there, guys. Had to do it. Bit of chaos bed vestiges fun there. I knew that was coming. I just knew this guy had a goddamn black flame. There we go. As soon as you force that trade, it's game over. But yeah, not much highlighting with the follower javelin on this particular video, unfortunately. But you know, when your opponents are willing to trade, or when you're able to bait them into trading, you just two-hand the Greataxe, guys. You know, you're going to come out on top. The poise breakpoints are going to, you know, help you defeat them. You know, you got HP regen on the side, and you whip these out as needed. So, like, it opens up the versatility so much more. I've made a point of this so many times when I make these dual wielding setups, guys, because you know, as good as this poise breakpoint system is when you understand it, just having just a heavy weapon as a main weapon and nothing else in your arsenal is a little bit detrimental, in my opinion, because I mean, you're going to have some effective counters out there and some good players who can counter you effectively, and it's good to have a selection in your equipment, you know, the weapon selection in your equipment to deal with those threats when you need to. Alright, so a mage. Looks like we're going to be going here for the messed that up, didn't I? We'll just dodge this, dodge this. Whoop! Try to dodge it. Alright, switching it up here. We could have shot him there, actually. Force a trade, force a trade. Got him. Alrighty, finally. Get to showcase the follower javelin as a sidearm. So any offhand weapon that has range to counteract your main weapon that has zero range is going to be awesome for you guys. Obviously it's easy to parry, so keep that in mind. But there, I mean, to finish off your opponent, having that range with a weapon that can poke, like the follower javelin, is awesome. And obviously it's not the longest spear in its class, but you know, I chose this one because it scales well with strength, now that we have a strength vitality build. So you know, that's why I'm using it. And it does have decent range, you can still get out pretty far with it to finish off your opponents, so you know, it's a pretty cool little setup, guys. I do advocate for you guys to try it out because it's a lot of fun to use. Anyways, guys, I might wrap up this little video here. I'm just keeping it short and sweet today, under 25 minutes. Another dual wielding setup complete here, guys, so give this one a try. It's a lot of fun to use. So you know, if you like this video, hit the like button. You know, if you're enjoying my content, please subscribe. And as always, guys, thank you for watching.